Can you see my screen?
Totally can.
Okay, I'm gonna make the movie big. Okay, you ready? Make a piece that was inspired by a piece of artwork or an artist. Mm-hmm. And it just so happened that I was going out of town and I was in LA and San Diego and then back in Columbus all within that time I had to shoot. So I just said, well, I'll just go. I went to Sabela. Do you know Sabela Grime? So I went to his class and I just shot whatever they were doing. And then I worked with Leslie Siders in San Diego. She wanted me to come into, she has this improvisation trio that she's been working with for a long time. And I was just in the studio mentoring, whatever. Mm-hmm. And then I came back, I looked at the footage. I said, like, need some more stuff. So I asked like three grad students to just kind of take up a motion that I mm-hmm. in there, and I put it together. So,
it brings up, I made a little list of things. I had my top 10 BBs, what I call them.
Ooh.
And one of the things I wrote was, and I don't remember if you remember me asking about this, but you were talking about sort of working a lot in solo form and sort of this extension you started making working with groups. And I said, well, what was that shift for you? And you said, oh, my imagination just got bigger.
Okay, yeah.
And so it just makes, I guess my question is, what part of, I'm wondering with this idea of video, like, mm-hmm. is that part of a bigger imagination? Does it feel like, and I know also when I think about things like taking sort of the structure of writing, the syntax of a writer, like it brings a new vocabulary, I think, to the way you might think about putting things yeah. together. So I'm yeah. curious about sort of video, film, this medium in terms of.
Well, a couple of things. I mean, I'm still really a student of it, so just trying to figure out how it works. But what shows up for me is kind of a reluctance to go into a complete narrative because I'm still stuck in, not stuck, but my preference is story-ness, not story. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So just trying to kind of find what becomes legible in a movie mindset, in a cinematic mm-hmm. view of people watch it flat from beginning to end, which mm-hmm. is a really different kind of thing than what we do with live performance. But we know it really well. So at the same time, I noticed how I aggregate different kinds of things, which I think I do in the studio. And so my eye feels really quick like this, which is not necessarily as linear mm-hmm. visually as people can take in what I want them to see. So I'm still kind of learning how to do that. But in the course of this course, it's like I changed how I do that. And I, I'm hoping poetry of it rather than the story of it. And I'm still working toward that. But I did one that is all about a chair, just like no people really, it's just a chair. And Mitchell wanted us to do looks, and excitement, so I'll send you the link for that. So it was interesting just trying to figure out like what is that visually without the or how do I kind of abstract what I get from a people situation yeah. into just a visual time and so playing with that is really satisfying. And you know, it is all, it's really editing,
yes,
which is
not,
yeah. And I mean, we do that, but you know, I think of the work we've done and it's not so much like editing things together, but just, I do feel like what is the best view to see you in relation to lots of things and people.
Yeah.
And so how to, I remember, I can't remember what piece this applied to, but realizing that one of the things I'm trying to do for an audience is like when they can go back and when they come forward. And yeah. So it is kind of editing a participation mm-hmm. and knowing that takes place. Yeah. So.
One of the words I always, when I'm asked to describe sort of your process or being inside your process, one of the words I always use is alchemy, like
oh, yes.
sort of this knowing what the elements are, but sort of this mix that can, depending on proportions or time or energy, can bring different states up. Mm-hmm. And even in that thing about sort of casting, you know, in terms of we have a Sarah or an Angie, you know, mm-hmm. or a Ted, or like the... Yeah. interaction between all those things.
Yeah.
feels alive, but also like what's the proportion that's needed. So when you talk about editing, that's interesting too. And also I think I'm thinking too in terms of, I would think there's a kind of collaboration just hearing you talk about some of the filmic processes you're going into between not only you, but the people that you're taping, the editor.
Oh, yeah, You know, I was just talking with this about this with Angie and Lila just the other day, and trying to, because I'm trying to, okay, the next project is sort of a cross between mentoring and choreography, mm-hmm. of trying to figure out like what is it that we do, what we have done, not so much to teach it, but just to share it in a way, in a studio. Like how would I? And it's come up because people, I just made two solos for different dance artists and with them, and realizing how much is not so much like I just want to make a solo on them, but I'm looking to see what else is in the room, whether what we are imagining or mm-hmm. put a chair in there so that there's something to relate to, mm-hmm. or you know, or there's something about the alchemy between that I feel like is really essential to what we have done together mm-hmm. over time, and how I might be reading that. And listening for that, and how we're hopefully all like kind of involved in some the word was killing floor, but that's not the right word, dancing floor, you know what I mean, but just like that alchemical floor uh-huh. of involvement, you know, mm-hmm. between us all. So yeah, I'm gonna be calling you about this, as you know, later on, but yeah
I'm ready. I've already told you that's one of the things that it's like, oh, I feel like it's been a structure in my life for 24 years, like even if it wasn't sort of a daily or a monthly, like I yeah. know that I'll be seeing you or we'll be in the same place or, and it's, I mean, it's about time too. I think it's, like when I wrote my 10 BB list, I did it sort of in chronological order. And it is, it's a span of time from points yeah. when I didn't even know you, but I was told about you. There's a guy named Big Bob. He was a choreographer when I was in, I shouldn't
edit this part out.
I know. There was a choreographer that came down when I was an undergraduate student. I was in psychology, and we were working on this project, and he said, "You remind me so much of this choreographer named Bebe Miller." And so, okay. I mean, I never. I was like, okay. And, I'm just gonna say they can edit out what they want to. When I was with Ron, he took me to, he's like, this is one of my favorite, you know, this is one of my favorite choreographers. And so he took me to come see you. It was your work. It was the Hendrix Project. I saw I think what they were talking about. It wasn't about really the dance you were doing, but there was something that was going on in your mind, like a thinking. In fact, one of the moments I just remember was in the Hendrix Project, you stood in a releve like this for, I mean, like 30 seconds. And it was something about the audacity, I think, of just, I have enough going on in my performative body to be able just to stand here and not do anything.
Wow.
Not do anything. It was like, there's something going on here, like the thought process or yeah. And so I think it was a time when I started dancing, when I think a lot of people, Ron had asked me, he's like you're gonna figure out what kind of dancer you are, and there were certain things, and that was one of them, that was like, that's something I want to be around, that's And I've already told you the audition story and all that kind of stuff. So I know. But that's good.
Apparently there's a list of people, but yeah, it's funny. It's funny, sort of.
It's appropriate. It's appropriate, I think, with the kind of, the other thing I have here is earn the release. I remember you teaching one time and it was something that made me understand release technique, because you did something that was just sort of like, you're working against gravity and you earn that release off of it. And it finally made sense in my body that in order to sort of let go, to feel this, and we've talked about this before, this sort of the release of the body, like you gotta earn that, resistance or friction is a way to sort of allow that state to come in. And so the friction of getting into the room with you, I think, was important.
I'm just kind of thinking about that earned release and kind of in 94, this is before we started working together, and I went to South Africa for the first time and worked in, and thank you, Tricia Pearson, because you arranged so many things that I did not have any idea of, and you got us there safely, so thank you. But anyway, we did a workshop in Soweto, and you know, this was like kind of this, you know, our improv kind of release work, and these young South African, Black South African young men came in white t-shirts and black tights. They had seen, you know, the classical Balanchine something, and they, you know, the effort it took to come in with tights and a t-shirt, you know, it was just like, I am so prepared to do this, whatever it is. And then we did something else, but just, it humbled me and touched me about a particular kind of effort to then allow yourself to be there.
Yeah.
And I thought, and I think maybe that was the trip. I came back and I said, I gotta study some body work so that I can kind of release our folks back and, you know, all of that, that striving, just like let it be. So we've earned it, you know. Yeah. And it's funny how just the language of stress, released, striving, earning, is tied up on so many levels in what we do that is not necessarily demonstrated. It's not about, let me just show you how that's going to release, but it's just that there's a knowing that we are living through what we both earn and what we strive for and what we earn and what we strive for, and that we're released all the time.
Yeah.
And so, I don't know.
You connected me to how I feel like I first connected with you, which was after a class, and I told you I was going to South Africa with my father, because my father had been going there every year in terms of the research he was doing in mechanisms of oppression and lecturing in a way of sort of, this is what we did here, don't fuck it up. Like, these are some about making it, you know, making this idea of liberation better. And he always used that word, that word liberation was really helpful for me as opposed to freedom. Like liberation felt like there was a real physical embodied way to as you're talking about sort of a striving of something.
Yeah.
That feels sort of a state of freedom. Yeah.
To liberate, to freedom, to free. Yeah, but to liberate is a different. Yeah. You speak so often and so beautifully about your father, you know, about both your parents and your grandmother and, you know, just family. And I'm always struck and about like what, you know, the length and the weight, not the burden, but just the what you carry forward mm-hmm. that way. And I, for some reason, I'm having, I just want to unpack the word legacy a little mm-hmm. bit, because I feel like it's too easy to drop into, you know, a particularity about elder, ancestor, parent, you know, a way of thinking, being, and I wanna like kind of clarify the trope of it, not so much just, you know, and like how it's particular to me or to, and to you. But I do think about what your father and the work that you're doing about going back to his archives and just listening and hearing him. I hear him through you.
Yeah.
And I have for a long time, yeah.
You know, there's part of it that feels like there's the, and I agree with you with sort of the trope and the romanticism, I think particularly yeah. with Black people or people of color around sort of that legacy yes. and ancestry, and I get it. There was also, I think, something where, you know, my father, I think, started to really teach me about looking very deeply, like, mm-hmm. and I feel like there's some connections, I think, with you with this idea of poly attention. You know, you always, you know, eternal vigilance, like.
Mm-hmm. Whoa, yeah.
I know, right? Like, it was always something about not only looking around, and he would use the word indicting the things around you, but also indicting yourself. Mm-hmm. And with that, it always made me feel like I don't really have allegiance to anything. Like, I really need to understand human nature in terms of, and again, I'm getting back into my father's kind of ideas about oppression being something that is not, it is an ontological reality, mm-hmm. what he would say. It's something that we can't escape as humans. And so it really has, it's filtered by ways, I think, about thinking and seeing. I think also with that in mind, it's not something that I hold on to. It feels like I can put that lens on and work in certain ways, and I can put a totally different lens on and work in other ways. Mm. So there's something about sort of a, and it feels like polyattention in that way, like I can hold multiple philosophical views in my body, and it actually feels like that's content.
Right, right.
Did you have someone that you feel like there was sort of a legacy or a lineage? It's not about where you came from, but I consider you a mentor. Was there somebody that you, at some point, that you considered a mentor or consider a mentor now? I guess I'm curious about when that shift happens between sort of yes. mentor, mentee.
Yeah, and teacher. And mm-hmm. and it kind of, it breaks down in different ways sometimes. I think my time working with Nina Wiener was totally impactive in not only kind of how I wanted, you know, what I learned about moving and how I wanted to like kind of unpack an idea about dance or physicality, but also about how I wanted to work as a director, as a choreographer. Mm-hmm. Without, as a director, I mean, I didn't even think about myself as a director until way, I guess, once I stopped dancing in the work, then I was directing. But anyway, but like what kind of a relationship I wanted to have with the people that I was in the room with, and picking up both things that that I didn't want to do like Nita, as well as what I did want to do. But coming back around, you know, time and again with Nina, of like, whoa, what I really learned how to value and recognize about just physical dancing, not like how much to do, but like what are the parts in action and what is the relationship between those parts, yeah. which I think would be invaluable. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, there's so many of my peers that, you know, from Ralph and from Jowley and from Susan Marshall, Stephen Petronio, like move, 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 move. And just people that I just was looking around at. I remember going to a Steve Paxton concert at Dance Space and realized that we were just in the room watching him solve a problem. And I was fascinated by that, mm-hmm. you know, the transparency of what he's trying to do, find something that he doesn't know the answer to, and that you can share that journey. So not solve it and then show it. Yeah. So I don't know. And I think as a Black artist coming up at the time that I did, that there was, you know, when you sort of realize like all the people who were in your life, and that there are others looking at that, they say like, oh, well, that person doesn't count so much because they're not who we think you are, or they're not on the Black side, or there's the white teacher, or there, you know, or these all the other influences. And I remember, you know, years ago of just like, well, but there are all these people. There's like, there's the dancers, there's Murray Lewis, there's me taking Gus Denny Zulu's West African class in New York. There's me learning Balkan folk dancing. There's all of this background of how does movement happen, mm-hmm. and where is our attention to it in the room. I think about that Balkan folk dancing thing I did for a number of years, you know, just not professionally, but just this being in a line of women with our arms really straight and fists held, hands held really tight, shoulder to shoulder, and just this up and down dynamic and percussive movement that was powerful. And where do I put that when, and who asks me about that? So I don't know. I mean, I'm grateful for time bringing me to, you know, I get to include what I want.
Yeah.
I always did, but you know, years of being self-conscious about that, and then like, well, this is what it is.
Yeah.
And then years of like, yeah, just moving on anyway. So, but lineage, I think of my mother, I think of how just she, you know, approached the world and her kindness and quiet.
Yeah.
That most people that I know just didn't know her, but I carry that. Yeah. So, you know, we are all containing these multitudes. I mean, that's for sure. And we all move through different times in our culture where the questions asked about that are reflective in some way of what's happening at the present moment.
Yeah.
But that doesn't make them more or less true than when you ask the same question 10 years later or 10 years prior. So, yeah.
There's something you're saying about the word, when I hear you saying the word lineage now, it's also, it's making me think, oh, a line. And there's something about associatage or something that, it feels like it doesn't have to go, and then I do this, and then I'm a choreographer, and then I'm a legend, and then and then I go back and learn something that I had made, with, you know, like there's, the associative things feel not only like a way to think about this time, but when I think about sort of process with you as well, like we can go from the coccygeal to looking out through space to like all these different ways of associating from a moment that actually sometimes, I don't want to say the word lacks a clarity, but it's purposefully not story. It the arc isn't always like this. And being in this process of rehearsing with you all these years, there's something about a push against white organizational culture that has always come up for me. Mm. And in terms sometimes, particularly when people are asking you, Bebe, can you be clear about this? You know what I mean? Like, and it's a certain kind of clarity, I think, that they've been asking for, that is, and you're purposely, and I wouldn't say obtruse, but like, no, this is the association. And I might not be able to explain it. And it might be something that might totally contradict the thing that we just did. But because of the nature of that kind of, I can feel the relationship of these things, even though they don't happen like this, still makes them valid. And I've seen you really fight for that. I've seen you fight for that in the studio. I've seen you fight for that in academia.
It's funny about how many times I've been told that, can you say that a little clearer?
Yes.
And I don't know if I can.
Yeah.
But I see your hands moving as you were just talking. Yeah. I see the dynamic of the space that you were enclosing or moving through or picturing in some way. And I'm realize that there's something that is not in the language of it for me, but in the three-dimensionality of being in the moment and sifting through in my mind and in my behind the thoughts of like, what is that push or release of idea with concept, with how to do it, and then the reflection historically on who did it beforehand. I don't necessarily have all that in my grasp, but I know that in the moment I am in my time trying to just circle through and gather the right words or concepts even to deliver.
It feels very hip hop to me. It feels like a mix. You're not trying to do the same song every time, but you know the elements, right? And so you're trying to get the mix, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that you keep it alive so that people keep, you know, in their bodies of the thing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm. Oh man, that's funny. I was thinking about Giselle, and I don't know if you saw, she was on the Fusebox Festival out of Houston, I forget.
Yeah.
But she was online last weekend with her No Boundaries project, and which is, you know, all of these solos from different Black choreographers. And it starts out with Rain, and I remember teaching it to her, I guess 2003, I guess. And like, you know, thinking like, wow, her weight is really different than mine because she's so much more up. And then like, blah, 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 oh, okay. And then seeing her do it, accomplish it, where she was so clear and so rooted and so there, more so than I could have accomplished because she's an amazing, you know, anyway, great dancing. I did it okay too, it was fine. Noting she also didn't have to, she did this Rennie piece, this hip hop piece that was like, go, and just kind of this other incorporated way of timing and being that she just kind of channeled through her those legs and back and all of that. And I don't know, I just thinking about what she aimed to do in that project was, yes, capture these pieces, but also capture all of us talking to her about like how to do that and what's important here and why this and not that. And Donnie McHale and she's receiving it. So I was really just struck by the container that she asked to be for us. And it was wonderful. I was really humbled by it.
Yeah. I think what a gift for her to be able to show you, mm-hmm. and to also probably feel like somebody's coming from my dad again, just in terms of, I was talking to one of his colleagues that was really trying to help him get his work together. Mm-hmm. And she said, you know what, Darrell, I don't think we could have done it when he was here. Like he wanted his hand in every single thing. He wanted the exact right word for the thing. And so there's something about this time that you might be spending when he's not here, but the materials are still here, where you can really assemble them. It might not be the way that he might have assembled them, but I'm sure that the ethos is there. Mm-hmm. And so just, and when I hear you say like, oh, she's not doing it like me, but like that space of, this is the lesson, this is what it is. Have fun.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Create and space. Also, yeah.
And I, you know, I think of, you know, with us working on a concept, and it's yours. I become a vehicle for you to get to where you're going.
Exactly.
And it's not the opposite. You know, I mean, it's just something. And I think that's an important thing when you think about lineage. We're all forward. We're not just thinking like, where have I gotten to?
Yes.
It's like, how can I shape this onward? Who's gonna listen to this? And what helpful? And what are they doing? And now that they've taken it on, what a lovely thing that is. Yeah, so,
And that permission, I think, too, because sometimes I think lineage can get very, you've changed it. This is different than the way we did it.
Yeah.
You're disrespecting the past. You're disrespecting a history in order to think about innovating something. And so like that permission to be like, this is the way that I did it. These are some of the ideas. Please take it farther or take it differently or keep it alive. You know, continue mm-hmm. with it. It feels like there's a release. There's a release in being able to, and it's something I feel like hopefully that I'm transmitting to the students as well.
Yeah. And it's curious when we really note that it's not so much that it's held in particular choreographies, but mm-hmm. maybe in the manner of the making or the teaching or the, you know, the resetting, that there is, it's in that language and repetition and going on forward and retelling of all of the elements involved in making a piece. Yeah. So rain is one thing, but it's the conversation about rain that it brought up between Giselle and I, say, mm-hmm. that she can take forward, that is not necessarily just about the piece. And I feel like that's what my interest is in a lot of this archival, artist-driven archives of creative process of how do we just know tracking a way of thinking about the world, not only the evidence of it in a particular piece.
Just a couple more, because we're probably getting out of time.
Okay.
Drumstick. Steve loves this one. That always cracks him up. Do you remember Drumstick?
Was that a leg? What was that?
Yes, yes.
Where did that come from? What?
You were teaching. And, you know, when I started teaching, I felt like I always had to be like, so the, you know, we're going to use a hamstring with the... the shin, and you know, I feel like I had to use these like technical terms in order to get the body to move with a kind of clarity. And so yeah. You're just like, get that drumstick swinging. And I could see all the bodies like really doing it. And so it was like, oh, I don't have to use like teaching necessarily.
Yeah.
Side meat. Side meat.
That's the other one.
Oh, yeah. Oh, man. Yeah. Oh, God. Yeah. Huh. Yeah. I mean, I'm really grateful for my time at Ohio State, I tell you, in many ways. And, you know, now that that has passed, I think of like, God, I could have done this part better and this other part better. But well, I guess that's any kind of a self-reflection you come up with that. But I think just even thinking through all the years at Bates and all these other kind of master classes or workshops or intensives, there's something about being in that room with people who are totally interested and available to what you have to pass on, and the reciprocity, that it's almost like in seeing them that you get to like say it is that, so bring more of this, and you get to articulate the way we use tools, the way we use our drumsticks. I mean, it's like I find out information in watching and feeling. Mm-hmm.